One of the most important things when we're looking at assets, whether they be intangibles or tangible assets, is impairment. It's one of the big issues that the SEC has always looked at. And of course, that could also make the AICPA and the CPA examiners more aware that this is so important for us to understand. So let's take a look at how those tests work. When it comes to impairment testing, we actually have three steps. Step zero. And the reason it's called step zero is because we originally had a step one and a step two, and then they added one up front. And what can you call it if you already have a step one and a step two? So they called it step zero. Step zero is known as the qualitative test. It's only available for indefinite lived intangible assets. So you're talking about the indefinite live, like a trademark. And what we do is we analyze this by making a determination if there has been, if the area is still the same, if the component or reporting unit is basically the same, there's been no triggering events, no bad things have happened, big fat cushions in the past, well then this is an exercise in the obvious. And since it's an exercise in the obvious, as long as you can document this, there's no reason to do any further testing. But that's only available for intangibles with an indefinite life. That's called step zero. For everybody else, you're gonna have to go down to step one. Step one is the test that's used for anything that has a finite life. So property, plant, and equipment has a finite life, and certain intangibles will also have a finite life. And if you recall, we've discussed some of those intangibles like patents, copyrights, franchises. They have finite lives. So they would be looked at here. So in this case, we look at, in step one, the undiscounted future cash flows. We compare the undiscounted future cash flows to the net carrying value. And if the undiscounted future cash flows are greater than the net carrying value, that's a positive, you will recover your money. You'll recover your investment. And if you'll recover your investment, no impairment. That's why we call step one the recoverability test. Will you get your money back? Doesn't matter when, just simply, will you get it back? But if the undiscounted cash flows are less than the carrying value, that's a negative, then you have an impairment. And now you must go down to step two. Now in step two, everything that failed step one, as well as all of your indefinite lived intangibles, like trademarks, they're down there. And we have to make another decision. Is this an asset that we're going to continue to use, or is it an asset we're disposing of? If it's an asset to be used, we look at the fair value, assuming we have it. If we don't have the fair value, then we use the discounted cash flows and we compare it to the carrying amount, and that's your impairment loss. You write it down, you recalculate depreciation over a new estimated life, and if restoration occurs, it's not permitted to be written back up. That's a big fat zero. If it's to be disposed of, whether it's going to be sold or just abandoned, or flipped out to the owners, then not only do you have the impairment loss, but you have to accrue for the cost of disposal. You write it down, you stop depreciating it because you're getting rid of it, and restoration is permitted because, of course, of the fact that when you sell it, you'd have a gain. So that's how the tests are done regarding impairment.